Welcome to the Selling Smarter Show, where we help business owners and sales pros sell smarter using LinkedIn. My name is Nicole Holgland, and I'm your host. So today on this episode, we're going to be talking with Alice Heiman about the future of selling and kind of dive into what that means for trade shows, especially given the business climate that we have going on right now due to the pandemic of COVID-19. Alice is the founder and chief sales officer over at Alice Heiman LLC and truly believes that sales performance is directly related to a leader's mindset. Welcome to the Selling Smarter Show, Alice. We're really excited to talk to you today.
Oh, and I'm excited to be here. We have some important topics to cover.
Yes, we do. So with everything going on, we are talking now in June, where everything is kind of opening back up. People are trying to figure out what the future looks like and navigate through all of the different changes that happened in the last 3 months. And before all of this happened, we really wanted to talk to you about trade shows because you are the queen of having tips about trade shows and selling and all of that goodness. But since we are seeing things starting to get back to whatever that new normal is, I would love to know your opinions on what you think the future of trade shows are going to be and how that pertains to how business owners need to switch their selling tactics.
I think that the future of trade shows at this moment is still very up in the air. I have been getting on webinars about trade shows, getting on virtual trade shows about trade shows. I've been reading and listening, and there's a whole lobbying group that is working with the legislature in different states and nationally to figure out how we can safely bring back these big events. So, you know, as states open up, the governors are going in phases, and events are one of the last things that are going to start again, whether they're concerts or things like we have a rodeo here in Reno or the Great Reno Balloon Race or things like that, festivals, that, you know, big gatherings of people. That's going to be one of the last things because we haven't quite figured it out yet. We can't always count on people to social distance themselves. And if we entice them to an event or if they pay to come to an event and then they get sick, someone is going to be liable for that. Mm-hmm. So we do have to really think carefully about how we can bring these events back. And there are people, lots of smart people working on that right now, the ways that we'll be able to do that. Trade shows will come back. Conferences will come back. Big events will come back. And all of the leaders in these industries are starting to post information about how what that would look like. So literally on LinkedIn the other day, I saw a diagram of how you would set up a meeting room for 100 people using social distancing. Mm-hmm. And it's just going to look much different. And until we have a vaccine and we have better ways to prevent people from dying from this disease, we will have to continue with more and better methods of keeping people distanced so that they can still attend, but, you know, and then of course all the sanitation and all of that. So I think we have some pretty good ideas, but it's going to be a while. Mm-hmm. I think the hybrid is going to come into it. I think what we're going to do is have some people there live, and we're going to have to live stream things and record things and make them available. So we're going to be innovative about it.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I think given the climate that we're in, the innovation is what people sometimes don't concentrate on because they're concentrating on what the normal was beforehand because that's what they're used to. And they can be a little bit wary of the change. But I think innovation is truly where we are going to shine and people are going to be able to come to the top of this and say, well, because we changed, we actually made things better. We didn't necessarily sit and rest on our laurels. And we figured out how to do it in a way that not only keeps everyone safe, but allows people to actually grow their business.
Yes, and that's important. So many companies depend on these large trade shows or these conferences with big exhibit areas to generate leads for their sales team for the entire year. And, you know, some of these companies maybe do 4 or 5 events a year, and that's how they get all of their leads. Some do one every month. They rely on meeting people, meeting their own customers, and meeting their prospects at these events. So it really has taken a piece away. And then some of us really thrive on getting together with everybody, you know, in these large event areas and love that so much. So it's kind of hard for some of us to think, oh my gosh, you know, we may not be able to do that again and see each other in person like that. So I think we do have to be innovative. And right now, if your main mode of generating leads was through trade shows, you have got to do some different things. You can't just sit there and go, okay, well, trade shows will be back in 2021, right? We all know that. We need leads now. So we have to do some other things besides hope for this, these live events to come back.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I know that the clients that you work with, a lot of what they did relied on trade shows, like you said. In the last couple of months, what have you seen them be able to pick up to maybe help fill that gap so that they don't necessarily just wait until 2021 to get new leads and to get new revenue in the door?
So there are a lot of things that companies can do, and none of them are brand new. These are all things that have been around, but maybe companies hadn't considered doing them. The first one I'm going to talk about is something that I have always really believed in, which is holding your own event and inviting exactly who you want to come to you. Now, this is easier than ever with the internet because we have tons of great programs. I mean, Zoom, everybody's using it, but besides Zoom, you know, just Google virtual event programs. There are dozens of them, and they have different features depending on what you want to do. But having an event where you bring exactly who you want to you is a really great way to generate high-quality leads. Now, that can be a mix of customers and prospects, which I always think is a good mix because the customers like to network with the other customers and with the prospects, and they can also be a sounding board because they already know what you do and love what you do and they can speak up. So if you have your own event, you could either do it simply yourself and invite some experts to talk and invite some of your clients to talk and just involve people in networking and different things. These tools that are out there today allow you to do all kinds of breakout groups and networking and, you know, introducing people. And there's a company that has a tool called Brain Dates, and you can actually have people sign up to talk to people about certain topics and they can get together. So many things you can do, but you can do it all by yourself and invite those people to you. Or you could pick a couple of other companies that you really enjoy partnering with that don't compete with you directly, and you could put on a mini conference yourself, right? And have great speakers and have some exhibitors and some sponsors, and again, invite the people you want to you. So that's the first thing that you could do. And some companies were doing that in person and having summits and inviting people, but we can do this online as well. And even more people can come because they're not restricted as much by travel or schedules or whatever. And it's also recorded. So if they miss it, right, they can still participate. And so you really can generate a lot of leads that way. With any event, though, it's still the same thing that I've always taught. It's really important what you do before, during, and after, but the before is really important. And with these virtual events, you have to engage people ahead of time. So here's an example. I had a virtual event recently and invited the CEOs that I wanted to talk with to that event. Prior to the event, I interacted with each of them individually. Now, this event was not a huge event, so it wasn't like thousands of people. It was just, you know, under 200 that I invited. But I sent each one of them a message about something about their business and asked them if they would kindly come prepared to the event. And I called it a discussion versus a webinar or a training. Come to the event prepared to share how you as a CEO have helped your sales team pivot so they could be successful during these times, and or prepare to ask a question. So I reached out individually to them and got them excited before the event, knowing that they were going to participate, and they came prepared. So we had a wonderful discussion because people did exactly what I asked them to do. They prepared something to share. So that's part of the before that you can do. Now, if you're inviting thousands of people, you can still have several pre-meeting emails that ask a survey question and say, we're going to reveal the results of this survey at the event. You could ask them to provide something interesting. You could ask them to provide a prize. Would you like to provide a prize for our event? So there's ways to get people engaged ahead of time so that then your event is so much better. So these online events are really important and you can do them in many ways. Another thing that you could do would be to sponsor an event that's already going on that's drawing the crowd that you want. So you were going to show up at a trade show and set up a booth and fly a lot of people there. And so you were going to have an expense that you now don't have. You could use that money differently. So you could get in there and sponsor an event that's going to be happening that someone else put on and get your name out there that way and perhaps be a speaker at that event and invite your own customers and prospects to that event and figure out ways to network with that. So having your own event is one way. Joining in on someone else's event as a sponsor or a speaker is another way that you can do it with a virtual event. But of course, there's also lots of other great ways to generate leads.
Well, and what I like about the tip that you gave is, especially now that everyone's kind of home, they're kind of figuring out what they're doing, your way is personal. It's not, I mean, there are things that you talked about where if it's a larger event, there are mass emails that go out and it can feel personable, but at the end of the day, you get a lot of data from it. But I think nowadays people really do like to kind of know that you're reaching out to them on a level that's maybe different than the same exact email that everyone's getting. And it may take a lot of work, but we all have a little bit of extra time now, and it really does make a difference to build that relationship to hopefully maybe at some point do some sort of business with them.
Right. Well, and think about it. Cold calling takes a long time too, mm-hmm. right? Cold calling takes a lot of time. Mm-hmm. So you could have an event and send tailored emails to people. Would that take any more or any less time? I mean, it's just deciding what you want to focus on, right? Mm-hmm. So I would rather hold an event and get the exact people that I want invited to that and take the time to send an individual email. Now, the interesting thing about these emails is part of the email is the same for everyone because it's the part that says date, time, place, you know, I hope to see you there, whatever. So that, of course, you can cut and paste in. Mm-hmm. And the first sentence, you know, you might tailor to that person or that company. So it doesn't really take that much time. And if you think about doing that compared to what else you might do, it's really so highly effective, so much more highly effective. I can invite 150 CEOs and have 50 show up live and have a real conversation with them. So, and have that interaction with them ahead of the event, have that interaction at the event, have some interaction after the event that makes them really see me as a person who wants to help them and know that I'm going to get business from some of those, or I can dial the phone 1,000 times and get 2 people to answer and schedule an appointment. You know what I mean? It's so you really just have to think about how you want to spend your time. Right now, especially when things are different and maybe people are not in the greatest mood to talk to you on the phone right now. Mm-hmm.
Well, and I think too, it's always about providing value. If cold calling provides you value in some sort of way, yes. that's their right. prerogative. But if you know that your audience really truly enjoys interaction and they enjoy learning and they enjoy mixing and mingling with people, doing some sort of virtual event is really going to be the key to helping that relationship grow and foster, because the value is always going to be the thing that's driving you as opposed to the sale.
Well, so for example, in this event that I just did, the CEOs didn't know each other. But they were interacting, you know, and I had all the videos up. It wasn't me presenting, right? So in the beginning, I presented a little and we did some polls to get some information and see that we were all on the same page. And then I turned all the sharing off and it was just our videos up there so they could see each other and they were talking, interacting and asking each other questions and sharing. And then, of course, they all wanted, okay, well, can you send out a list of who is on the call? Because we want to all know each other. And of course, I encourage them to connect on LinkedIn. And I thought, well, you know, you got to be careful sharing personal information these days, emails and such. So I just made a LinkedIn group. And all of the CEOs who attended the event, I put them into the LinkedIn group. Public, right? It's all very public. And then they can, it's up to them to connect with each other on LinkedIn. And if they want to share their email or their phone number or schedule an appointment, that's totally up to them. But I gave them an avenue to continue that conversation after the event. And there's tons of other event tools that you can use to help people interact as well. And I think it's so important if you are going to do an online event, remember, one of the reasons you go to trade shows and conferences is to see your friends and to meet new people. So the online component has to have that also. I get to see my friends and interact with them, and I also get to meet new people. So to have an online event without the networking component is not very exciting to anyone.
And honestly, at this point, no one really wants to just sit through an event and be sold to. They really do want and need that interaction. It's almost like a craving type thing because they know that that's lost at least for the next couple of months. So if you can provide that for them, that right there starts the relationship off on a really high note.
Yes, absolutely.
Awesome. So what other tips do you have for anyone who's listening to this, who's like, I don't know if I want to do a virtual event. I'm not sure if I want to sponsor it just because it may not necessarily be a fit or my audience may not be there. What can other people do during these times to help kind of move the needle forward when it comes to generating some sort of sale?
There's so many things. And again, none of them are brand new. I don't have any magic up my sleeve. In fact, I barely even have a sleeve here. So I think that LinkedIn is a great place to network. It is not a place to pitch or sell, you know, or send a spammy email that you would send, you know, to them over the email. LinkedIn is a place to start a conversation, to connect, to get to know people. And so if we use it properly, we can meet so many people right now. So perhaps your company writes a blog, you know, post the blog, make some comments about it, but tag people and ask them to comment and get a conversation started. Or participate in other people's conversations. So you see that someone's posted something you're interested in, join the conversation. Add a comment, converse with some of the other people who are conversing. And if you are conversing in the same location as they are, it's easy to then connect. Oh, I see you commented on Nicole's post. And I agree with you. I'd love to connect and share more ideas. So now I've made a connection with someone I wouldn't have, right? And I can look through all the people who are commenting and find the kinds of people that I want to connect with and interact with them and then send a connection request. So you can use LinkedIn to start conversations and network just like if you were in person. But what people don't like is when you send them connection requests that says something like, oh, I was strolling by your profile. What do they say? Oh, I came across your profile.
I
thought we should connect. Why? Right? Or they say some, you know, I am sending you this request with the intention of connecting. I'm like, what? I don't even understand what that means. So, I mean, I do, but I don't. Like, why do you want to connect with me? So I think in person, if you were at an event, you would walk up to somebody and smile. You would shake their hand. You would exchange business cards. You would ask them what brought them to this event. Or is it their first time? What have they heard that, you know, is interesting? You wouldn't say, hi, I'm Alice Heiman. I sell. Here's my link. Click and get on a call with me so I can sell it to you some more. I wouldn't do that in person, but first, well, maybe some people do. I hope not. But they're doing it online and over again. And it's really making it hard to want to use LinkedIn anymore because every time I open it and see, I have all these connection requests. And as soon as I connect with someone, they send me this long message that should have been sent on an email or should never have been sent anywhere anyway, but it's the type of thing you would send on an email. That doesn't work, by the way, just in case any of you were thinking it did. I mean, I know it works some of the time, but a very small percentage. So instead of that, interact with me, you know, converse with me on somebody else's post, on my own post. If you want to know me, then get to know me, just like you would at a networking event. Interact. and then send a connection request, and then tell me why you wanted to connect and, you know, something interesting, and maybe share some content, but don't just try to sell to me immediately. Have a conversation with me, get to know me. And then if you go, oh, sounds like she might need what we have, I'll ask her if she wants to jump on a call and chat about that. Mm-hmm. But that's not the first thing you do. So you can use LinkedIn very effectively to get conversations with qualified buyers if you're willing to take the time to have a conversation first. So I think LinkedIn is really a great tool right now. It always has been, if it's used well.
Exactly. And everyone's flocking to LinkedIn right now because it is It is the business to business social media tool. But what people are forgetting is the social aspect of social media. And they're looking at it as a place to strictly pitch and try and get their calendar filled and try and at least get people quickly in the door so that they can maybe close a deal that they lost just due to the pandemic or anything like that. But I think the key takeaway from this is the way to utilize LinkedIn, the best possible way, is to start having relationships there, starting a conversation, and just taking the time to do research. I know for me personally, anyone I connect with, I always do research, even all outside of LinkedIn, to make sure that one, I'm connecting with them in a way that feels authentic, but two, I know who they are a little bit before I actually say, okay, it's time for us to connect. I've read your blog. I think this is really interesting. I think you would be valuable in my feed when I do take the time to scroll and read stuff. So at this point, I think it makes sense for us to connect. Because at the end of the day, I don't want my feed clogged up with things that I just don't want to read and I just end up scrolling. I want it to be filled with valuable things based off of people kind of sharing that same mutual interest.
Right. And I don't want another cold list. So I have probably close to 18,000 connections. But every time someone asks to connect with me or I connect with them, I start a conversation. And even if they don't respond, at least they know that I was being genuine in trying to connect with them. It was their choice maybe not to, but most people will start a conversation with you. So mm-hmm. I have right now like 20 conversations going on in my LinkedIn inbox with people that I'm getting to know. And so now I have a list of people who know a little bit about me, and they would be willing to make an introduction for me, or if I ask them, invite them to an event, they might come, or if I ask them to comment on a post, they might do it because they know me a little bit. And it's not just I'm connected to a complete stranger who I know nothing about, doesn't know me, doesn't care about me. That's why I'm careful even with who I accept a request from, because I don't want to just have a big list that is worthless. I want to have people connected to me that want to be connected to me and want to interact with me and want to share whatever they have to share and receive whatever I have to give.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Again, it's all about relationship building, knowing your audience, and also just knowing what they can potentially get from you and vice versa.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. One other thing that's working really well right now is direct mail. Now, this is a little bit difficult with people working from home, but most people have a way to get their mail mm-hmm. from their office. But you can send out handwritten notes to people, postcards, you can send out gifts. And some people, you know, of course, they're not going to want to give you their home address, but someone at their office is going to get the mail because mm-hmm. they have to. You know, there are important things in there, like checks that they'll want to get too. So you can send people something. And I just, yesterday, I wrote 6-7 handwritten notes to people mm-hmm. and put them in the mail with a stamp on them.
Yep. Well, I don't know. It does. Handwritten notes are one of those things at RevGrow. Mark, who's the CEO, and everyone knows this, he'll write at least 20 to 30 handwritten notes a month to people just to see how they're doing. Doesn't have to be anything sales related, but just say, I was thinking about you. This popped into my mind. Just wanted to see how you're doing. You know, hope all is well, Mark. And that's it. It doesn't take much, and it doesn't even take a whole lot of effort, but it's that personalization and the effort that it takes, because handwritten notes are kind of a way of the past. A lot of people don't necessarily realize that those are still relevant, and the feeling that they get when they receive it is going to kind of help build the relationship more, and they'll remember it more so than an email.
Absolutely. So I think those are some things that you can do right now. Of course, there are others. I do encourage you, though, to try having an event of your own. And even if it's small, even if only 20 people come, those are exactly the 20 people who were supposed to be there. Mm-hmm. So don't think you need to have hundreds or thousands of people at your event for it to be a success. The event I did recently, like I said, I wanted a smaller group because I wanted it to be a discussion and not a one-way me just giving information. I wanted these CEOs to talk with each other, and they did. It was successful. But we didn't have, you know, hundreds of people on there. We had less than 50 people, and about maybe 25 or so were heavily interacting. The others were just chatting things in. So it makes for a good mix, right? Mm-hmm. So don't think that it has to be some huge event to be successful. It can be a small event where you can actually talk to people as well. But I do think it's a great idea. And I do think that you should look into sponsoring some events that are going on that are successful, because there are a lot of events still happening online, and people are investing a lot of money to make them exciting and interactive and have the networking and all of the other things that I mentioned.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, I have thoroughly enjoyed talking to you today. I know that everyone's kind of itching to have some direction as things start opening up and have more of a strategy laid out for the rest of the year. And I think the tips that you just gave are going to help them get light years ahead of where they've been so far, and maybe even spark some innovative ideas for themselves that they didn't even realize they can do. So why don't you tell everyone where they can find you after this episode? So if they do have any questions or want to learn more about what you do, we'll easily put those in the show notes for them.
Well, of course, you can find me on LinkedIn. So it's pretty easy. And when you send a connection message, please mention that you heard me here on this show with Nicole, and let me know that's how you found me, and I'll connect with you. And then if you have questions about trade shows, please ask them. If you want to know, I've got plenty of resources I can send you on how you can look to see all of the different event software that's out there and all of the national organizations you can follow that are providing the latest updates on whether there will be trade shows or not. So there's quite a bit of information from several organizations, including Exhibitor Magazine, who's, you know, always up to date on these things, so you can follow them. But any questions that you have about generating leads and keeping your pipeline full and helping your leadership team grow sales, I'm happy to answer them. So please connect on LinkedIn. You can, of course, also go to aliceheiman.com, and I have a blog there where we share a lot of information. And then for our trade show, we have tradeshowmakeover.com. It's a separate website with information about trade shows as well.
Well, thank you so much for sharing all of your tips today, Alice. It was a pleasure talking to you. We will have all of those links in the show notes for everyone. Thank you so much for listening to this episode of the Selling Smarter Show. And remember, don't sell harder, sell smarter. I'm Nicole, and we'll see you next time.